Welcome to the second episode of A Spy in Exile, Inside the IRA.
This is a series of interviews with the former MI5 and Special Branch agent, Martin McGartland, who infiltrated the Provisional IRA in the late 80s and early 90s in Northern Ireland. Due to the serious threat on Martin's life, this has been recorded over a secure connection, and his voice has been altered to protect his identity. If you missed episode 1, The Making of Agent Carl, it's now available on YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and other audio apps. To make it more direct, were you involved in murder within the IRA?
Up until my kidnapping, I actually spent probably the best part of 2 years inside the IRA. When I was inside the IRA, all the jobs that I actually prevented, which the IRA would refer to as operations or ops, OPS, was, I think, 40 or 45. Now, that would have been bombings where they're going to put a bomb on top of a car, which they would call like a limpet mine, bombings where they're going to put a bomb, in a vehicle to actually blow up army, police, obviously to pass by, bombs that they were going to put under cars, or shootings where they're actually going to go and shoot police officers virtually like in broad daylight in the street. Now, the whole time that I actually was inside the IRA for that 2 year period, one person was targeted as a result of information that I actually had known about, probably about 4 weeks before, a guy called Tony Harrison. Tony Harrison was a black paratrooper. And what had happened was, he was going with a local guard from East Belfast, and he was going to a house in Nevis Avenue. Unknown to Special Branch or me, he was actually a British soldier. We only found out later on that he was either on leave or he wasn't actually supposed to even be in Belfast. But what happened was, he actually was going to arrange, I think he was getting married to this girl in East Belfast. And at one point, he had been stationed in Palace Barracks. I was contacted by somebody who I just referred to him as Jimmy, because I couldn't name him for any legal reason. And what he done was, this Jimmy guy, who was a member of the IRA, had came to me and he said, "Look, Marty, will you do us a favour? Will you drive me over to East Belfast?" And I said, "You'll take over." And it transpired that he had been asked to actually go over to target a soldier. Now, when he said soldier, I presumed it was a UDR soldier, because one thing that you need to take into account is no British soldiers actually live in any part of Belfast, let alone East Belfast. What happens is, they go on a tour for 6 months and they stay in the barracks, and then obviously they go back home, and then a group of soldiers comes in for 6 months, and that's the way it works. So when he mentioned soldier, I presumed he met obviously a UDR soldier. So long story short, he asked me to take him to East Belfast. Now, when I took him to East Belfast, he took me along Hollywood Road. I was driving the car, and he was actually interested in a bus stop. Now, the bus stop, from what I was led to believe, this soldier, because we didn't know nothing else, was either going to be getting on a bus or getting off a bus at that bus stop. After we passed the bus stop, this Jimmy guy had said to me, "Look, go up here, turn left, blah, blah, blah." And he took me into the streets, which is in behind, obviously, the Hollywood Road. Now, one of the streets is Nevis Avenue. Now, that's obviously important to this story, because it turns out later on that Nevis Avenue was the street actually where this soldier was going to. Now, bearing in mind at this stage, no one knew he was a British soldier. No one knew that the guy actually was didn't even live in Belfast or Northern Ireland. And more importantly, no one knew that he was a black soldier. Now, the reason why that's significant for was because he would have been easy to identify, so no one knew this at the stage. Jimmy got me to drive up and down must be three or four different streets in around there. One of them in Nevis Avenue. I dropped them back to West Belfast. And almost immediately after I dropped them back, I went and contacted my handler, Felix, explained what happened. And when I contacted Felix, he said to me, which wasn't unusual, look, you need to come and meet us. Now, when I go to meet them, I always went to mostly the same place. Now, some people may think, well, that's a bit suicidal, but I always met them at the top of the Craigie Road. It was safe because obviously it was a Protestant area. And when I went, Felix and another special branch man, who was another of my handlers, asked me to take them, firstly, like, meter by meter, and explain exactly what we had done earlier that day with his Jimmy. So I went and done it. Same again, went to the bus stop, drove up, drove into the streets. Felix was sitting in the car, taking loads of notes while the other special branch man was driving, asking me questions. And I'll never forget this. This is something very, very significant. Something happened when we were doing all of this checking and trying to get information and stuff and all like that. We drove up one of the streets. It was close to Nevis Avenue. It may have been Nevis Avenue. And Felix had said to the driver to stop the car. And I looked, and he was really, really agitated because there was a Montego car. But the Montego car was an RUC. Armored, sort of like it was an unmarked police vehicle, and he was going absolutely ballistic because that car shouldn't have been parked there because it was on its own. Somebody could have actually put a bomb under it, blah 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 blah. So he made notes of that, the registration number, the house number it was outside of. After he'd done that, we drove around all the streets again. Once that was all done, same again, brought me back. I get in my car, went back, and they went back to obviously Castlereagh. And their job was then, from that minute, was to actually chat with the UDR and also probably with the RUC to find out if any personnel lived in those streets that I had identified to them, yeah? Because we didn't know what street it was the bus stop in them streets. And they went back and they'd done their stuff. So as far as I was concerned, if there was a UDR soldier in there, or if it happened to be a RUC man, who they probably, the IRA were actually, like, you know, probably trying to give me a bit of a, you know, bum steer, then in all likeliness, the special branch would actually, like, be able to identify that person. I heard nothing more about it. Then what happened was, a short period later, I actually, now one thing you need to remember here is it's very important, obviously you take into account this is at a time where all the other operations I had stopped. And as I say, there was 45 that I counted, and probably a few more that I've probably never even probably taken into account, had all been either stopped or they had been prevented and something had happened. But when I went to, at that time, I was actually, like, you know, in a cell who, it was a guy called Spud Murphy, who was actually in charge of the cell. And Spud Murphy was looking after a cell, which was, like, heavily involved in, like, shootings and bombings and stuff and all like that. And I actually had been told by Spud Murphy that I actually had to, like, drive cars and stuff and all like that. That was my main job. They wanted me to drive because of the reason I said you had a driving license, blah, 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 blah. And I usually went to meetings with Spud Murphy and the rest of the team, which was, like, the cell active service unit. One day, I actually got a knock on the door. Someone came to the house and said, look, Marty, you have to go to a meeting that same afternoon. Now, that wasn't unusual. That happened all the time. And the reason why that happened for was because Spud may have been tied up doing other things. He actually, like, you know, probably couldn't organize things way in advance, or he had other things coming up where he had to squeeze things in between. So I went to this meeting. And when I walked into the meeting, Spud Murphy said to me, Marty, this isn't a meeting. You're going to go with them too. And it turns out that the two people he was pointing to, you know, the blood drained from me because I knew these two people were top in this team. They were top, sort of like, they were shooters, people who was involved in just basically shootings of people. And when they were involved, I mean, you know, if they were targeting you, unless something drastically went wrong, or unless something actually happened where it was called off, that would be the only thing that would actually prevent the target from actually being murdered. So he said to me, you're going with these two people, even at that stage, I didn't have a clue where the fuck I was going or what I was doing. Now, the reason why Spud Murphy done that for was because at that time, he knew or he suspected that I was one of a few people who must have been passing information on. Because a small cell, like I mentioned to you earlier on, people can actually, like, you know, it's an elimination process. If we're six people or seven people or eight people, it's easier to identify the person who's talking or the person who's actually leaking information than it will be if it was 800 people or even 80 people. So that was the reason why they brought me to this meeting that never was. I actually went. I had to get drive the car, and, you know, I was being told, look, you know, drive here, drive there, drive the other. Well, when I get into Belfast Centre, I thought, well, fuck me, where am I going, blah, 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 blah. It turns out that when I was told to drive through Belfast, yeah, heading over towards the Hollywood Road, the closer I get to the Hollywood Road, obviously alarm bells started in my mind going, fuck me, I hope I'm not going where I think I'd been, obviously, only a few weeks ago. And it turns out that I was actually asked to drive the gunmen over to the job that I had actually tipped the special branch off about only a matter of weeks before. And that's how that all came about. So in answer to your question, yes, I was actually involved in an IRA operation where a person was actually murdered. But like I've said on the John Moore program, and I've also said on the book and every other interview I've done about it over the years, that I was in a position where there was no way I could have actually not actually went along with it, because other than me, Hans, hang on, Spud, I've got a confession. I'm actually working for Special Branch. But I think at that stage, Spud must have, at the very least, suspected me of working for Special Branch, because I told another story. I'll go back to this Tony Harrison thing again, but I told another story in the past where I actually went to a meeting with Spud's team that I was a member of. And when I walked into the meeting, they were all very, very surprised to see me there. And they were looking at me as if, like, basically, like, I had, like, two heads. And one of them said to me, Marty, don't worry about it. We'll buy your ETH. Now, I've told that story 100 times, and that's exactly what they said to me. And that was all around the same time as all this was going on. But as I stress to you, I mean, my memory is that the Tony Harrison thing happened in June 1991. Now, you have to put this all into context. I was kidnapped in August the 8th, 1991, only weeks after that. At that time, like I said, the fact that Spud sent for me to go to a meeting wasn't unusual. That happened all the time. But to get me to go to a meeting, to tell me the minute that I walk into the house, Marty, this isn't a meeting. You're going with Eason's on a job. At that stage, that's basically when I realized that, you know, the game was as close to being completely up as it ever could be. But remember that I actually was asked by Special Branch to infiltrate the IRA at the age of 19 in 1989. So 1990, 1981, nearly 2 years. So everything that I did in that 2 year period up until that time, June 1991, I was in a position where all that stuff, the IRA and its internal security team and other people in the IRA were starting to go, who was involved in that? Tick, 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 tick. Who was involved in that? Tick, tick, tick. Marty, 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 Marty. My name keeps coming up left, right, and centre. And one thing I want to mention too, Tony Harrison, it was me who told John Moore on the BBC and the BBC Informer programme about the Tony Harrison case. And the reason why I told him for was because, one, I would never ever live with myself if I never actually had told the whole truth about my whole story. Two, I could have easily said nothing, but again, that's not me. You know, the consequences of me telling that story in some people's eyes would be, well, you know, he's an out-and-out thug like them and he's involved in terrorism, blah, blah, blah. Well, you know, that isn't the way it is, simply because, I mean, you have to put yourself into a situation where you're in a room with people who are involved in the IRA and they're saying to you, you're going with these people. So in other words, I would regard it as like duress. Some people say, well, don't talk shit. Well, I would say, no, listen, what else could it be? I mean, what do you do? Do you say, oh, hang on, I'm not going? Or, oh, do you know what I mean? Or what do you do when you're on your way over to wherever this job is, because I didn't know where this job was until virtually I started to drive through Belfast City Centre, and then obviously that when I was driving towards Hollywood, and I thought, fuck me, I've been here with Jimmy, and then I've been here with Special Branch in Phoenix and stuff, not only fucking like a few weeks before. And then obviously it doesn't take obviously like, you know, fucking Einstein to work out, well, hang on, this is no coincidence. So what I'm saying to you is, the answer is, yeah, I was involved in something where the IRA actually did murder somebody, but on the basis that I was sort of like duped into going to a meeting, but it never was a meeting.
For those who aren't aware of who Tony Harrison was, he was a 21-year-old soldier from North London who in March 1992 was deployed with his unit, C Company, on a four-month emergency tour of duty in County Tyrone. On June the 19th, 1992, Private Harrison was off duty and visiting his fiancée who lived close to Palace Barracks. His presence there had been seen by the IRA, and pretending to be postmen, a murder team forced their way into his fiancée's house and Private Harrison was shot dead. Was there any chance, Martin, that Tony Harrison's life could have been saved in any way?
No, because I'll tell you for why. Lots of things have actually come to light over the years since it happened. And there was a court case, and I'll just give you a little bit of a summary of what happened. Unknown to me, obviously at the time, I'm talking about back in 1991, the IRA were using people to gather intelligence for them. They were using people in all sorts of organizations. Examples, travel agents, taxi depots, taxi drivers, people who work for Department of the Health and Social Services, people who work in the driving license agencies, etc., etc., etc. And unknown to me at the time, and it's came to light since, the person who set Tony Harrison up to be murdered was a taxi driver. He was arrested, and he's since been convicted of it, that Tony Harrison either told the taxi driver that he was a British soldier, or the taxi driver actually must have gleaned information out of him that made him suspicious. I suspect that Tony Harrison must have told him, because one thing I know about the IRA is, right, they wouldn't go targeting somebody unless they were 110% sure that the person was what they would regard as a legitimate target. So I suspect that, sadly, Tony Harrison had told the taxi driver who he was, thinking the taxi driver was actually, like, you know, an innocent person. But it just so happens, and unfortunately for Tony Harrison, the taxi driver was an IRA intelligence officer. This guy went to court. I think he called the guy Thompson again. Don't quote me on that. This is all memory. I think the guy was called Thompson. And the guy actually got jailed for quite a few years. And he had said, and again, this is memory, that he had met a childhood friend who he knew was in the IRA, and that mom was coming to meet him, I think it was once a week or whatever, to get information from him. My understanding was that, again, from the information I've gleaned since, that Tony Harrison wasn't even supposed to be in that area. Nobody from the army was allowed them. Areas were classed at that time as out of bounds. So I get the impression that Tony Harrison, one, didn't go to get permission to go into East Belfast, or if he had went to go and get permission, he would have been told no. So I think he just went in because it was like he wanted to be with his girlfriend. He was going to actually, you know, sort out his wedding, blah, 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 blah. That's my understanding of what happened. But during the court case, it came out that Special Branch had actually had intelligence that a soldier was going to be getting targeted in that area. And I think I'm 99.9% sure that they had said in the court case that they were unable to identify that person. Now, again, you have to look at this in the cold light of day. That isn't like, I mean, that was exactly what would have happened, because think about this for a second. Tony Harrison didn't live in Belfast. Tony Harrison didn't have sort of like nobody knew that he was actually home, or he was staying at his girlfriend's house, other than a taxi driver, because he must have picked him up a few times. I don't even think the army knew he was there. That's the impression I've got. And people who I spoke to recently, I spoke to somebody who was in the parachute regiment with Tony Harrison at the time. And I'm led to believe that Tony Harrison virtually just went, and he just basically decided that he wanted to go to be with his girlfriend, and he just decided that he wasn't going to follow all the proper sort of like proper procedures and stuff and all. And he probably decided that he didn't want to go and get permission of the army because he probably knew it was going to get refused. But long story short is that this guy, Thompson, was actually put in a taxi depot with other people. And he was in a taxi depot that was used frequently by people who actually were soldiers based in Pollock's Barracks. Now, another thing which is significant about that, that same taxi driver, unknown to me, actually gave the same IRA unit, the one that I was a member of, Spud's team, information about a group of soldiers who he dropped off in Belfast City Centre. And the IRA had come up with a plan. The IRA decided to go down. They recce'd the area, yeah, and they went into the Bolton site, and they come up with a plan where they were going to drop a glass sweet jar full of Semtex explosives on top of the actual group of soldiers as they walked along the alley, which was actually below the scaffolding. And I told Special Branch about that, and they actually acted on it to make sure that obviously, like, that the soldiers wouldn't be there. Another thing which is even as important, the same taxi driver, and again unknown to me until much later, was the same person who tipped off the same IRA team about the banger Charlie Haggerty's job that was going to be, and I don't even hesitate in saying this to you, yeah, the Charlie Haggerty's operation, if it had went ahead, was going to be the biggest massacre that the IRA ever carried out in its history, period. Now, them three things all came from the same IRA intelligence officer who was a taxi driver. I was able to stop two of them. The third one couldn't be stopped for the reason they give you was because no one knew who the soldier was. And no one could have known.
Tell me more about the Charlie Haggerty bar gun attack that the IRA had planned. A large number of British soldiers had been socialising there. That information had made its way back to the IRA. You passed on the information that helped stop that attack and save many lives. But unfortunately for you, by doing that, you left yourself completely exposed to the IRA?
They weren't just British soldiers. The reason why the IRA were so keen to actually fulfill that operation was because they were actually paratroopers. And the IRA had an absolute hatred because obviously of Bloody Sunday and stuff and all like that. They had a real, real hatred for paratroopers. So all those soldiers who were actually going to be the targets for that operation were all paratroopers.
Why would the IRA have risked such precious information on a huge, or what would have been a huge operation, getting into the hands of an informant in their ranks?
To be honest with you, I mean, even a long time before that, they were actually suspicious of me, but they must have been so desperate to keep the actual operations that they actually were, you know, had in the pipeline. They must have been so desperate, obviously, to keep it so tight that they just basically were hoping that by actually having me still on board, albeit, like, giving me information at the very, very last minute, that they would be confident that I wouldn't be able to actually pass it on. Because one thing I'll say to you, and I mean, and I've read this before, this is also significant relating to this banger job. The IRA had a UFF informants giving them information. I mean, I've known that, obviously. Well, everybody knows that, anybody who was inside the IRA. I mean, I actually prevented a bombing on the UDA headquarters when I was there back in 1990-1991. So what happened was the IRA were getting all that information from people who were actually loyalist paramilitaries. I don't know how they done it. it was probably maybe they thought by giving the IRA information, the IRA wouldn't target them, blah, 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 whatever. But that's what was happening. But the reason why I'm mentioning that force for this reason, at that time, yeah, I mean, everybody who was actually, like, you know, working in the cell that I was in, the Spud Murphy cell, yeah, they were people who were actually sort of like handpicked. I only got obviously selected for the Spud Murphy cell because Davy Adams and Brian Gilley, who was the head of the IRA in Belfast at that time, actually brought me to a meeting. Me and Davy Adams went to a meeting with Brian Gillen, Dave's home in Leonardtown, and Brian Gillen put my name forward to this cell for me to actually become a member of it. So what I'm saying to you is, right, that cell was so neatly, it was so meticulously put together, yeah, they didn't want actually anybody else to be brought into it. So they must have thought, well, if we're suspicious of somebody, they had to just say, well, look, we will give them information at the very, very last minute, i.e., what they did with Tony Harrison. Now, the reason why I'm mentioning that for, and the reason why I'm mentioning about these loyalist informers passing information to the IRA for, was because, right, in a situation like that, right, the UVF or the UFF, they were actually starting to do what the IRA were doing. And what that meant was they were riddled with informers and agents, right? And what they started to do was the fucking loyalist paramilitaries were actually copycatting what the IRA was doing. It was becoming public knowledge because of people like me copping on TV that the IRA were bringing me into fucking meetings at the very last minute and saying to me, you're going on an operation in 5 minutes fucking time or 2 minutes time. So the UVF and all watching these programs and watching on TV, they're getting ideas. And what they started to do the same thing. So if they were suspicious about somebody, they would just say, well, we think he's giving information to the branch. We'll bring him in at the last minute. Tell him he's going out in a job now. He can't contact his handlers. He's going to be involved in it, whether he likes it or whether he doesn't. And therefore, it's not going to be getting compromised. So the point I'm making to you is, right, you're fucked when you're in that situation. You're completely fucked. I mean, it doesn't matter who you are. You have to ask yourself this question. What do you do if you're actually a plant, if you're actually working against a terrorist organization and you're inside that cell passing information to the IRA's enemy, Special Branch and MI5, and they decide they're going to bring you to a meeting, only to find out they're going to send you on a job? What is that person supposed to do? You can't say, oh, listen, I've got a wedding to go to, or my missus wants me in the house by 6 o'clock. I have to leave. You'll have to go without me. There's no rule book. So the reason why I'm mentioning that before was because the banger job at that stage, there's no doubt whatsoever that Spud Murphy and the IRA as a whole definitely knew that I was passing information on. It wasn't unusual for either loyalist paramilitaries or Republican paramilitaries to actually bring people who they believed were actually suspected informants to meetings under the false pretense.
It feels like we're living in the golden age of scammers, from Anna Delvey to the Tinder swindler. But they're amateurs, next to Joubert Schickley. From Wondery and Pineapple Street Studios comes the new true crime podcast, Persona, The French Deception, the untold story of one of the greatest criminals of the 21st century. To hear the full story, follow Persona, The French Deception wherever you get your podcasts. Or you can listen early on Amazon Music or early and ad-free by subscribing to Wondery Plus at Apple Podcasts or the Wondery app.
As they're actually going to be meeting, when really they're not, they're going to be actually sent out on a job. I'll repeat this till my last breath. That banger IRA operation, hands down, would have been the biggest massacre that the IRA ever carried out in the term of like murder of British soldiers, especially paratroopers. You have to look at how many people they must have killed in one IRA operation. On the banger job, my memory, again, I have to go and check, don't quote me on this, but my memory is it was at least 100 and, fuck me, I think it was about 150 or 200 rounds of ammunition, and they were using two AK-47s. And the two AK-47s, the two people who had the AK-47s had the magazines doubled up. So what that meant was there was 30 rounds in one of the magazines, and whenever they actually fired them 30 rounds, yeah, they switched the magazine over and they had another 30 rounds. So the two gunmen who was going to go into the Charlie Haggerty's bar, after they had identified all the people, were English accents and short haircuts. They were going to be drinking with these people, and then they were going to go out to the car outside, take the weapons out of the boot, walk in, and all the people who they knew were soldiers, spray them with AK-47 automatic rifles, and they were going to fire 120 rounds. Now, just imagine that. 120 rounds of ammunition from AK-47, as well as a Browning pistol. And then when they finished that, Spud Murphy, the orders were telling them that they had to leave a bomb behind so the emergency services couldn't tend the wounded and the dying. So what I'm saying to you is, the best way to actually like try to make a comparison is to look at any other terrorist attacks in Northern Ireland, that the most high profile ones. And is it Long Island and stuff and all like that And you look to see how many people was killed. And then you say to yourself, well, what sort of weapon was used? How many rounds was fired? And then you think, well, if they fired that many rounds and the IRA team who was doing that job were going to fire 120 rounds of ammunition, bear in mind the gunmen. These gunmen were like really, really fucking ruthless. I mean, they were the IRA's basically top fucking shooters. And I'm telling you now, when they were getting in there and they knew paratrooper, they were getting in there and they weren't going to come fucking it until they'd done some pretty serious damage. That's the reason why I keep repeating this thing, that would have been the biggest massacre that the IRA ever carried out. And I mean in its whole history, because of the amount of firepower, the amount of ammunition that we're going to discharge in such a small confined area. There's videos online of Charlie Haggerty's. It was a well-known place where all the people used to go dancing on a Friday and Saturday night. You go and look at the YouTube videos from that time in 1991. Do you see the fucking many people on that dance floor dancing about and stuff? It was going to be a massacre. And the orders from the IRA commander were, if any woman try to act heroes, I'll never forget this, shoot them.
Those are shocking and chilling claims, Martin. And it was this proposed massacre that actually led to you getting exposed.
Right now, Trish, one thing I'll say to you, and I mean, really, and this is me speaking, obviously, with all the wealth of fucking information that I've got in my head and all the information that I've gleaned and all the fucking documents that I've actually obtained during the past fucking 30 years. I mean, it wasn't just the Charlie Haggerty's. I think it was quite a number of things that was happening in that previous 12 months, whether it was like Tony Harris and Charlie Haggerty's. And, you know, if a bomb is planted under a car and the policeman mysteriously finds that bomb under his car, it isn't unusual, but it's suspicious. But if another policeman finds a bomb under his car and then another one, you know what I'm saying? So what happens is all these bombs is all getting found and stuff and all like that. And I remember Elaine in the film, and it makes me laugh. Jim Sturgis is in a room with Kevin Seegers, and Kevin Seegers is playing Harry Fitzsimmons, supposed to be, and Jim Sturgis is playing me, and Kevin Seegers is putting the bomb together, and I'm Jim Sturgis, look at him like intently, and fucking, we're talking about bombs and stuff and all, and Jim Sturgis says something like, oh, we're going to blow up the whole city, man, and Kevin Seegers looks to him and says, nothing ever blows up when you're around, and that's exactly what it was like. Nothing ever blows up when I'm around. That's the fucking truth.
You led a double life that you successfully kept from your partner at that time. How did you do that?
Well, you know what? Listen, it wasn't hard, because at the end of the day, as I said to you, I've always been a very, very active person. I mean, from a very, very early age, I had jobs where fucking like, you know, was up at... I mean, since I was a young lad, I mean, I worked with Paddy Brady. I mentioned this day before. Paddy Brady was murdered by Michael Stone. In fact, Paddy Brady was one of the first people that Michael Stone actually murdered. And I worked with Paddy Brady up until about maybe 2 years before he was murdered. And I actually will never forget. It's actually stuck in my mind's eye, obviously, to this very day. And you're talking like 40 years ago. I used to actually get up out of bed and I used to pedal through Ballymurphy, Beachmount, right down into fucking like, you know, the village, which is a Protestant area, down into Kennedy's Dairy, where Paddy Brady used to work. And I used to put my little bike in the back of the milk float, fill the milk float up with Paddy Brady and a couple of air helpers. And we used to go back to West Belfast and we used to deliver people's milk. And I used to go out to do that. I used to leave the house probably about 5:30, 6 in the morning. Pitched it black to pedal. I mean, it must have been at least 5 or 6 or 7 miles. And I used to go down it, and I always had jobs. I was a very active person. So the reason what I'm saying to you is, right, when I was with my partner at the time, I was always active doing things. So it was easy for me to go and meet fucking somebody from Special Branch. It was easy for me to be able to go to meet IRA people and stuff and all like that. And it wasn't unusual for me never to be in the fucking house.
For most people, their partner is their most trusted confidant in life. Why didn't you tell your partner that you were working for a Special Branch? Was there a reason?
Yeah, but listen, I'll tell you one thing, Trish. I mean, your partner's probably the least person who you should fucking trust with your life when you're in that situation, because no disrespect to you, but know the old fucking saying, the woman scorn and stuff and all like that. You know, when a woman falls out with a fucking man for whatever fucking reason, she's not too fucking slow about starting to shit, and you're doing this and you're doing that. You couldn't do it.
Take me back to the day that everything changed, and that is the day the IRA kidnapped you and planned to murder you.
It was on the 8th of August 1981, because I was getting mixed up because the 9th of August is internment. It was the day before internment, on the 8th of August. And what happened was, the day before that, the day before that, which would have been the 7th of August, someone came to my mum's house. And what they said to me was, look, you have to go to a meeting. I was told that I had to go to Conley House. Now, bear in mind, this is the day before, so 24 hours notice. Immediately when I got that fucking message, right, what made me even really more fucking concerned was, I was told I had to go and see Padraig Wilson. Now, Padraig Wilson at that fucking time was well connected with internal security and fucking discipline prior to that. So he wasn't no fucking sort of nobody. He was like a fucking very important person within the IRA. So I was told I had to go to the Sinn Féin headquarters up in Conley House in Ambushenstown. So the minute that that went, the minute that that fucking, the person who came to tell me actually told me that, I made my way, obviously, back, because at that time, I was having a bit of a fucking, I was having a bit of a ding-dong with my ex-missus, the one who had the two kids too, Angela. And I actually fucking had to make my way back to our house in Ballymurphy. And the reason why was because I used to have a little device, Special Branch gave me it, and it was like a little white radio, a little sort of like small compact radio. And what happened was, rather than me calling them, because obviously if I was seeing the phone boxes and stuff and all like that, would be really, really dangerous and suspicious. I used to have to press a little button on this radio, and it sent the message through to my handlers, yeah, that we had to meet. I think it was within 30 minutes or 1 hour, and around that. And the minute I pressed that button, I started to head to the meeting place, which again, I told you, was over basically just off Craigie Road and over like East Belfast. So what I did, I went and met them, and I went and met Felix, who I really trusted. I said to him, look, I'm not going to go to this meeting. There's no way I'm going to go to the fucking meeting, because obviously, you don't know what's going to happen. They knew that I was going to be getting kidnapped. I knew I was going to be getting kidnapped. Ian Phoenix, in his book, admitted in his diaries that Special Branch knew I was going to be getting kidnapped when I went to the meeting. But yet, fucking unbelievably, I had been told, and again, I have to stress to you, I mean, this may be a little bit fucking out of sync of what I've said previously, but it's there or thereabouts. I had been told by Phoenix when I met him, right, that, look, don't go back to West Belfast, don't go back into Ballymurphy, blah, 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 because he was convinced that it may be some sort of a trick to make me believe I was going to go to this meeting the next day to meet Padraig Wilson, But the IRA had planned to come and get me either that day or later on that night before the meeting, you know, leave me in a false sense of security. So he had said to me, right, leave it with me. And he says, I'm going to go back and I'm going to speak to people. He said, and what to do is call me this afternoon. He says, and whenever you call me, he says, I'll tell you exactly what we're fucking going to do. So long story short, I'm fucking shitting myself all that day. This is the day before, 24 hours before, on the 7th of August, 1981. And I'm running about really, really fucking thinking, fuck this, I'm not even... I had a bit of money, right? And I was convinced. I had convinced myself that I was actually going to get a fucking plane or a ferry and I was actually going to leave fucking Belfast and I was never going to go back to it. I was actually frightened. So what happened was, I contacted Felix later on that day and he said to me, we want you to go to the meeting. I thought, are you fucking nuts? He went, no, listen to me. We want you to go to the meeting and we're going to fucking put surveillance on you and we're going to follow you every step of the way. He says, so if anything happens, we're going to be there, obviously, and we'll fucking, like, we'll be virtually, like, there with you. And I thought to myself, fuck that, blah, blah, blah. I was sent, you know, virtually, like, to go and do my own fucking day-to-day fucking sort of, like, activities as if everything was just normal. With this thing in my mind, knowing full well that I had to actually fucking go. The next morning, if I made it that long, because I was still convinced the IRA were going to come get me that day, that night. And I was fucking convinced that I was going to be fucking, like, kidnapped the next day. And I probably would never, ever fucking, like, you know, see the 8th of August, the end of the day. I was so convinced they were fucking going to kidnap me, torture me, and murder me. I fucking decided, like a dopey fucking idiot that I am, that I was going to put my faith in the fucking special branch. And I was going to go to this meeting on the hope that they were actually going to come good. So the next morning, I'll never forget this. I was actually staying at my mum's. Because the society, me and Angela were having like a bit of a rough, we weren't getting on, stuff and all like that. And I remember that next morning, I'm not a cuddly person, you know, like, well, not back then. I am more so now, but not back then. And, you know, you weren't really, really like that type of person. Like, you weren't really all cuddle, cuddle, kissy, kissy, you know, blah, blah, blah. And my mum ironed me a pair of jeans that morning before I left. And I remember... And it's as vivid now as it was back then. I was going to tell my mum at that spot, at that time. You says earlier on, no, why did you not tell your girlfriend, blah, blah, blah. And I says, woman's going, blah, blah, blah. But I was so close to telling my mum exactly what I had been doing and what I was about to do and what the special branch were going to do. I was so close to telling my mum, yeah. And I also remember thinking, look, I'd love to give her a little cuddle and kiss and tell her, like, you know, a lover or something like that. Because I knew that my days were, like, fucking numbered. And I believed that I was going to be murdered, like, that day. I didn't believe I was going to see the end of the day. So anyway, I left. I didn't give my mum the cuddle, and I didn't tell her these things and stuff. And I wish I had, because see if I had told my mum. My mum would have told me, don't you go to the any meeting. And she'd have just said to me, get yourself away. Get yourself away to this danger. Get yourself, go anywhere. And she'd have told me that. Now, I'd listened to her. But because I was listening to the special branch, I actually stupidly, and because I trusted my handlers, I went ahead with this fucking plan. And the rest is history. History being, what Special Branch told me was, don't use your own car, borrow a car, and when you borrow a car, contact us, tell us the make, the colour, the registration number. So I borrowed a car of a friend of mine, a guy called Jim Quinn, who lived just like the next street. And it was a little Nissan Cherry, a very, very metallically light green car. And I borrowed his car, and Special Branch gave me instructions to say that I had to park that car up at the corner of the street where the Anderson's Town News was, in between the Anderson's Town News and also the Anderson's Town Leisure Centre, that street that runs down the two of them. And they said, there's a billboard there, and there's like a little parking space for a few cars. Park it right onto the billboard there. And when you park it there, you walk across the street, and you go to the Sinn Féin Centre. And my instructions were that I must not, under any circumstances, tell the IRA that I travelled there by car. Now, I didn't know what the significance of that was, but I'll explain to you in a minute. But I want to go back a little bit before I carry on. You know, because I was still so frightened, and because I wasn't actually convinced that the special branch were actually fucking really, really, like, going to be watching over me, and they were going to be fucking, like, you know, protecting me, I decided on the way to the Sinn Féin headquarters to this meeting with Padraig Wilson that I was going to go to a payphone and I was going to contact Felix. And I remember I drove down the Mona Bypass, and I think it was the Glen Road roundabout. I took a right, and there used to be a little phone box beside a little small number of shops. I think it was facing a church or a chapel or whatever. And I parked there, and I went and made a call, and I called. And Felix, and before I did that, I done anti-surveillance round a roundabout about three or four times. Now, the reason why I did that for was because I thought the IRA might be following me. And when I knew I wasn't getting followed, so I thought, I went and made this phone call. And I'm not joking you about it. When I made that phone call, Felix came on the phone to me, and he said to me, "Fucking hell, what are you doing? You're putting your head on a spin by all this fucking maneuvers going round and round about." And when he said that to me, I just got this sort of instant sort of confidence, and I was relieved, because I believed at that moment, one, they're following me, two, they couldn't have possibly known what I'd just done 5-10 minutes before, and three, if they're with me, then I actually am confident enough to know that if the IRA training, I'm going to be getting rescued. So I thought, fuck it, and I just drove to that meeting with a completely new sort of newfound confidence. I felt I was being protected, but the top and bottom of it was, I was being used as bait. I was being used as bait. I'll just mention something to you here, which is a bit of a side issue, but it's very important. But what had happened was there, yeah, if you can imagine, the special branch wouldn't have found it very easy to recruit people who would have, they would regard it as good type of sources, right? They were either going to get somebody who was a downright terrorist, who they recruited because they were able to blackmail that person because they got them in a compromised position, and that person knew that he was going to go to prison, and his way of getting out of jail card was to work for special branch through gritted teeth. He hates the special branch. He hates the establishment. He's a fucking seasoned terrorist, and he doesn't want to fucking be basically given information against his comrades and stuff and all like that. And he's only doing it because it's his way out of prison. He's never going to be truthful to special branch. He's never going to be truthful to MI5. He's just doing what he has to do to keep himself out of jail. Well, what happens is, right, when you're dealing with people like that, right, they're easy to find. You can get people like that all the fucking time because they always make mistakes and they always get themselves into positions where they actually do compromise themselves, maybe through crime, maybe through something stupid, maybe through something that's embarrassing, and maybe through just something where they just basically fucking are vulnerable for whatever reason. But what the special branch were doing in MI5 at that time, unknown to me, they were allowing people like me, alarmed to the slaughter, walking into the fucking Land's End, somebody who had put 4 years of my fucking life, sacrificed everything, give my all. You couldn't have placed yourself in any more danger. I would actually say that the job that I was doing between I was 17 and 21 was perhaps one of the most dangerous jobs that anybody could have done at that time in the United Kingdom. It was one of the most dangerous jobs you could have done. And as I said to you, bring in weapons, bring in explosives, bring in all these things to special branch to do whatever they had to do to bring them back, blah, 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 all those fucking risks, and put myself basically at the mercy of MI5 and special branch because I believed in them, but they didn't fucking believe in me. And what happened was they basically were just using me. Well, the hierarchy were using me. Here I am going to this meeting, really a kidnapping, disguised as a meeting. Special branch are following me, but special branch aren't giving a fuck about me. What they're doing is they know that the people who I'm going to meet are part of the IRA's notorious internal security team. Now, at that time, no one knew about Freddy Scapaticci's and stuff and all like that. No one knew about them. So what happened was when I went there, they had surveillance on me. But the surveillance wasn't for my purpose. The surveillance was for the fucking actually get the people who were actually going to take me away to God knows where. and the people who they were going to take me to get completely cast iron, indisputable evidence, hard evidence against them to be able to turn them into fucking informers. And I went there and I found out in 1997, and this is in the second book, Dead Man Running, I mentioned the bloke's name is Mike, and that's an alias name. And this guy obviously met me in England, and he told me that you were not supposed to come out of that flat. A decision had been taken at the very highest level that you were just going to be basically sacrificed, because he told me, and this is before Scapatici, this is 1997, this has been in, Scapatici wasn't out until 2002 or 3 or whatever it was. He told me, it's in there verbatim, he told me that you were actually sacrificed because they were protecting a more senior agent in the IRA. And I've always believed now, because of what I know, that that person is possibly Freddie Scapatici.
How did you feel about that?
Do you know how I really feel about it? I feel really, really sort of angry with myself. Because when you give somebody everything you've got, you just think to yourself, if I hadn't jumped out that fucking window, you and I wouldn't be having this conversation now. And do you know the sad thing about it is, and I can say this without any hesitation, many other people who were proper agents, agents, not informers, agents, agent being in the definition, my definition of an agent is somebody who is not in any way associated or a member of a terrorist organization, but they are already an established agent for either one organ of the state or another, MI5, Special Branch of the Army, and they are actually inserted into that organization for the purpose of actually gaining intelligence and information about the workings, future operations and stuff and all, and thinking, and also what the IRA or that terrorist organization is actually involved in, right? I believe, without doubt, even before I heard about Scapatici, because I never knew who the fuck Scapatici was. I'd never heard of him before in my life, until obviously he was out in 2003 or whenever it was, or 2004. But one thing I can say to you is this, right? I honestly do believe that dozens of other agents have actually been sent to their deaths by the people, MI5, and the people way up the very, very top of the command chain within the RUC and also Special Branch, the people who make the fucking decisions. And I believe that they've actually been virtually sent to their deaths. If you know that you've got somebody who was doing the work that I was doing for Special Branch, they're actually knowing full well that that person, without doubt, is actually going to end up dead. They know that I'm going to end up dead, or other people like me, yeah? And they know full well that not only am I going to end up dead, but the people who are actually involved, at the very least, of my abduction and interrogation, i.e. in my case, the people who I've been aiming all along, I have always said that they were either informers before I actually was kidnapped, or that they were actually blackmailed in becoming informers as a result of my kidnapping, because of the surveillance that was gathered and the evidence that was gathered against them. But since then, it's even got more murky. I found out that the third man in the fucking flat was actually somebody who was already working for Special Branch 2 years before my kidnapping. So if I'm right, potentially the whole three of the people who fucking kidnapped me were all working for one organ of the fucking state, either Special Branch, MI5, or the Army, and all of them were all working for them. So it's not a bit of fucking wonder that, you know, I wasn't ever going to be fucking rescued. And as I say to you, I believe it's happened to so many other fucking people. That's what really makes me sick. And I believe that mine wasn't just sort of like, you know, a one-off. And that's the sad reality about it. And to me, what they were doing was, they were just squeezing someone that they got every fucking inch out of them, yeah? And then when they were completely, virtually, like, you know, there's nothing more they can give, like in my sort of case, they thought, fuck them to the side and let the fucking wolves just eat them. Eat them, eat them alive. And that's what they done with me.
Take me back to that day that you walked into that room. No one. That you could have lost your life.
bottom was, I went to the Sinn Féin Centre. Two people who I've named fucking for the past 30 years actually came in and told me, here to see Padraig Wilson. I said, yeah. They said to me, look, Marty, he's not actually able to come here. He said, but he's told us that, like, you know, he can't make it. If you want, we can take you to see him. And this is what they said to me. You can go away and come back another day. Well, when they said that to me, I thought, fuck me, this isn't that serious. So I thought, no, I'll go and see him now, get it over with. And we walked out of the Sinn Féin Centre. I think it's called the Busy Bee Car Park. That's what it was known to as me. Walk around the side, out of the Sinn Féin Centre Comedy House. Right turn, walk along the street a little bit, into a car park, a shopping precinct. Walked over towards a little white Fiesta, four-door Fiesta. I get into the back, them two's in the front. So we're driving along, and the thing that really, really fucking made me see, oh, I'd made the biggest mistake of my life was, they actually spun, the wheels were spinning out of the actual junction to go on the Anderson's Town Road. And I thought, fuck me. Obviously, they're doing this in case they're getting followed. So what happened was they drove the whole way to Tunbridge. I'll never forget this. As we came to Woodburn Barracks, I was so close to actually trying to open the back door and jump out of the car the minute that we passed Woodburn fucking Barracks. And I would have done it, because I jumped out the fucking window later on. I would have done it, don't you worry about that. But what happened was, the reason why I didn't do it for was because I thought they would have put the chain locks on in the car. And if I'd have tried to get out, then that was it. They give the game up. The game would have been away. They would have known at that minute. So I thought, no. And I also thought, I'm going to put my fucking hands around this cunt's neck when I pass fucking Woodburn, just choke him until he stops the car. All these things looking through my mind, because I knew, like I said before, I wasn't going to see the day. I believed I was going to be fucking brought into a little country fucking lane, shot a few times in the back of the head, and just left like all the other poor fuckers before me. So I goes ahead anyway, and I goes to Twinbrook. Car stops outside the flats. One of them jumps out, runs in front. The second one jumps out and says, Marty, come on, follow him. So I gets out, follows him up the stairs, goes up into the fucking flat, walks in, nobody else there. And then what happened was, the two who I was with went into the kitchen, and then they come back out with a third person, who I hadn't got a clue who he was at the time. And they just said to me, Marty, provisional IRA, you're under arrest. And I thought, fucking hell.